What the hell are Dotfiles and why do everyone share them publicly on GitHub? Well, Dotfiles are usually a collection of configurations for your system and other tools, mostly command line but not only. They get their name from a hidden Unix files, starting with a dot, a convention many tools adhere to. For example, you probably know .bashrc or .bashprofile, .vimrc, .gitconfig, zshrc, and the list goes on. Okay, but why do you need them in a structure, let alone shared? The fact that you're allowed to configure an application using a file is quite amazing in its own. Think about it, you can configure your terminal to load the same shortcuts, aliases, and scripts you like. You can tell tools like WesTerm, my terminal emulator, to use a color scheme, set the background to transparent mode, and set the font I like for coding. What if you want to duplicate that configuration to another computer? What happens when your disk decides to suddenly die? And what if you wiped an entire configuration segment only to find out you got rid from a critical set of options you now have no idea how to reset? Consistency, customization, recoverability, portability, and beyond all these, learning by sharing with the community are all benefits of holding a public .files repo. With that in mind, let's jump in and build our .files from scratch. A .files repo is a collection of files which are more easily trackable placed under directories with the system's names. Looking at a tree structure shows why. Sometimes you'd want to add a bunch of additional files, scripts and subdirectories, so mapping an entire directory to your configuration path makes more sense. There are a few ways to do this. The most obvious of all is creating a /.config repo and place all those configuration files there. This is your home directory. But we want to build something robust and easy to read and maintain. So we're going to map every directory under .files at /.config using symlinks. You can see why. Not every bit of configuration under the config directory should be stored for long term, let alone pushed to a remote repository. This is another reason why separating your .files persistent configuration from a local copy is more sensible. To add trackability and enjoy the benefits of never losing a piece of code, we'll make this a Git repository. Among many other advantages, we can fire lazy Git, for example, and explore changes made over time. Not all configuration files behave the same. Take tmux for example. When placed under .config, it'll take the form of .tmux.conf, while under its own directory, it'll lose the dot and stay tmux.conf. You don't necessarily have to remember that, but do keep in mind different applications tend to do different things when it comes to configuration management, so you'd have to tweak things at first when moving to a structure like this, like you're seeing here. That said, after the initial config, it's all about updating and pushing. Okay. So we talked about structure, we talked about mappings. Let's take things a step further and automate them the Unix way, with Stow. Stow is a simple, native Unix application that maps a given directory to a given target path using symlinks. This saves you the trouble of maintaining links whenever you change or update your system with one command. Let's see it in action. I'll create a test directory and run Stow targeting my home.config. You can see test added as a path reflecting the link. What if I add .test in the test directory? Well, that's reflected in the config on the left as if they're the same. That's another reason to keep the structure under directories. It allows for dynamic updates without anything to do on my behalf. For example, I can add tmux plugins or neovim lua files without having to Stow again and again to make any changes at all. The symlink directory takes care of everything. There is one issue with .files though, which you may find a non-issue at all. Hidden files are, well, hidden. A closer look at /test, for example, using Finder shows as if there are no files there, although we did place .test. And while you can solve this by reconfiguring Finder or another file explorer to present hidden files, there's a reason why this config exists. There's a more elegant solution when working with Stow, and it's called .-files. If I configure .-test under test directory and run Stow with a new flag, --.files, it'll now have .test under .config pointing at my .-test file, essentially allowing me to keep non-hidden files as configurations while mapping them to a conventional .files via Stow. I like to keep things straightforward, so I'm not actually using this feature, but I definitely see myself in the future finding a good reason to change things. One thing to note is that Stow is ignoring by default a bunch of files when linking, like .git and other gitconfig files, licenses, backups, etc. You can bring your own ignore file by configuring .stow-local-ignore, and that needs to be present when running the stow command if you wish to make additional changes to the defaults. This entire video is talking about how everything should be configured with the Dotfile while stow is running ad hoc commands, and that feels out of place. Time to create a stow Dotfile. .stowrc. Let's create .stowrc by adding the flags I'm using every time it's run, which for me stays --target and /.config. If you're thinking I should just remember this flag and just run it, well, the amount of times I had to go back to this repo, readme file just for the flag and run stow again, that's all the reason I need. That's it. Stowrc is ready, and stow followed by dot for the local path does its magic. I can be sure of that because stowrc is now also mapped under .config. Now that I've confirmed that it's working, I think I'll add a small ignore line, removing stowrc from .config just to keep things clean. Another quick run shows that it actually wasn't mapped, and while I'm at it, I'll add a couple of additional ignore lines removing other files should not be mapped. This, of course, can either be done here or with a local stow ignore file. Another reason, important to note about why .files should be a Git repo, is the ability to run tools like Git leaks to scan for leaks and secrets you don't necessarily want on GitHub, surely not on a public repo. Another great reason is the community of developers not only using your configurations but also suggesting additions, like this chap here suggesting I add stowrc, which we just did together. I'll use nix to run an ad hoc command for git leaks. Don't worry about nix, I'm using it here just as a runner without having to install git leaks for the sake of presentation. More about nix in the video up here. Running git leaks detect shows a clean repo, no secrets or keys were found, so I can safely push the updates to my remote at omrxx/.files@github. Quick note, Nix fanboys should now start saying things like Nix Darwin, Home Manager, and others. And you're right, but Nix.files management is another level of complexity, which I'm exploring in a video very soon, so stay tuned, subscribe, and all that. Now that we have our .files repo structured and pushed remotely, it's time to test it in a real-world scenario, a remote environment. And what's better than a remote cloud instance that takes config, loads it, and sets everything up? To do that, we're going to use Coder. Coder is an open source platform for self-hosted environments. They also have a super cool browser-based IDE named Code Server that has 66,000 stars on GitHub and can run anywhere. You should definitely check out both. But since we want our own environment, I'm going to use Coder in a much cooler way. First thing first, to install Coder locally, you can use a bunch of methods, the simplest of which is their installer followed by the command Coder Server. Once the server is up, I'll pop the URLs it created. One is the localhost server and the other points to the same instance but with a public URL, which is a nice feature. After logging into the dashboard, you're going to see a few things. Workspaces, templates for environment creation, and the rest of the tabs are for management and system admin options, and we'll touch them later. Let's start by creating a template. You can create yours from scratch or upload one if you have it, but I'm going to use the starter template Coder provides. You've got AWS instances running different operating systems, as well as Azure, DigitalOcean, Google Cloud, and more. I'll use a good old Docker container to run things locally, but my own server is running on a remote AWS Linux instance with the exact same configuration I'm going to show now. Creating a workspace is done by clicking a pre-compiled template built earlier. I'll name the server and let it run. While my server is booting, let's check out what's under the template's hood so you can also configure your own. Under source code, you can see the Docker file, as well as main.tf covering the Terraform code that's creating the cloud resources for us. Coder provides a dedicated tool for booting an instance configured with .files. By adding a variable with my public .files repo, yet another great reason to host it in a public space, and a line that runs coder.files command under Coder agent section, I'm telling Coder to download my public .files and run a setup script so that when I log into my server, it already has everything in place. I'll edit main.tf file and add the two bits, making sure I don't break anything. I can then go to the terminal feature in my workspace and get a browser-based shell session to explore my environment. Sure enough, my .stowrc, which we built earlier, is present, but it doesn't look like my home configuration directory. To fix this, let's get a real shell on the server to see what's going on. I'll run coder login, which pops the browser with a token. Once that's done, it's time to configure SSH. Using coder config-ssh, which sets my SSH daemon with the proper settings. SSHing into coder.dotfiles-server, and there you go, a real shell. It seems that my .files were properly cloned, but there was nothing there to run stow. To do that, Coder follows GitHub's workspaces convention, looking for one of these setup scripts in the root so that you can set up the configuration files. I'll create my own setup.sh, making sure it's executable. I'll add a simple stow dot, since all my other flags are already managed by stowrc, and that's pretty much it. Next, we'll make sure the container with my environment has stow along with neovim and tmux that I would like to run with my dotfiles. I'll build the template, and it's also important to remember to publish it. This is a concept well known to ops people from server templating with cloud providers. Now that the server was rebuilt with the new config, let's see the result. Tmux is here, which is nice. Firing up neovim immediately pops lazy, installing my plugins, LSPs, and other configs. I can happily create an example Golang Hello World app with the Go LSP in place, syntax highlighting, tree-seater comments, and even Codium's AI code completion. Telescope, of course, is also present with all my favorite pickers and key bindings ready to go. Nothing to configure or worry about, fully automated end-to-end. While Coder can serve you well with the open source free tier, it also comes with some cool enterprise features. Coder was also kind enough to sponsor this video. If you're looking to use the same config at scale and give developers in your company the power of automatically setting and destroying dev instances in the cloud, coder.com is the perfect solution. There's a huge list of features, so go to coder.com and check it out. Last but not least, while we've used Coder's CLI for logging and a simple SSH session, almost any operation from the dashboard can be achieved with the CLI for us terminal-based users. It's great for automating the Coder server, as well when you decide to take things seriously and launch it in production. You can list workspaces, monitor metrics, view running servers, list users, etc. Super cool to use and a well-thought-out product for devs and ops together. I've started managing my dotfiles years ago, publicly. When I started this channel, it was an incredible help with referencing configuration to people asking questions, as well as receiving help with setups I was trying to push. I think it's not only useful for content creators, anyone likes automation, playing with local configuration, or just being able to describe configuration as code so that it's pushed and pulled from a remote server can benefit dotfiles management. And since dotfiles is all about managing your Git repository, here's your next watch. The best Git integrations in existence for neovim, making your life 25% better when running daily GitOps. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.